Good morning, everyone. Rector, the rector is gone, I see, while I was pouring the water. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for the invite. It's a great honour and privilege to be here to remember Ian. Istvan asked me to say a few words about Ian, so I met Ian in 2005 at the Irish African Studies Conference, and we struck up a great friendship. For many years he visited me, I visited him. We collaborated. For those of you who are looking at your alerts, you see Ian is still publishing. Books, articles are still coming out. He's publishing more than us, even though he's no longer with us, unfortunately. But in thinking and talking about Ian, I think one of the things I hadn't realized when he was alive was just the impact he had on people. And when he died, there was a collective outpouring of grief in the African studies community. And as you talk to people, you realize he impacted so many people across that community in so many different ways as a mentor, always volunteering to be on PhD committees, give people feedback, search out work, unlike many of us who claim we're too busy to do these things. So he was an inspirational figure, and I'm, as I say, delighted to be here to have the opportunity to remember him with you. So my talk today is entitled, you'll see it there, Post-Peak China in Africa. And I want to talk to you about whether China's influence economically and politically has peaked in the continent, either in the short, medium, or long term. And what are some of the indicators and trends which will allow us to kind of analyse whether that's the case or not? Some of you may have heard this term before, globalization, or deglobalization as it's sometimes called, but you'll see here, already from 2005, trade as a percentage of gross domestic product in the world's major economies is falling. Okay, so globalization is a generally increasing process, but it's recursive, it's dialectical, it's subject to setbacks and to change. And obviously COVID impacted that heavily as well. But China seemed to buck the trend through, in particular, its Belt and Road Initiative. And you'll see the map over here on the left-hand side showing all of the countries with memoranda of understanding to be part of this Belt and Road Initiative. And I probably don't need to tell you too much about it. It was announced in 2013 by the Chinese president in Kazakhstan. And fundamentally, it's a major program of infrastructure, financing, and construction, ports, railroads, power stations, roads, etc. Heavily focused on infrastructure, but there are other dimensions, people-to-people exchange, policy coordination, and so on. You're all probably familiar with the Belt and Road Initiative. So Chinese inflected globalization seemed to be a counter-trend to this, and this is because it's a particular form of globalization which is heavily state-directed, in contrast to Western-led or the previous type of corporate-led globalization, which still exists and interpenetrates and influences the Belt and Road. The state in China is able to do things that a lot of other states aren't able to do, given the importance of state-owned enterprises, corporations, and banks in that country. Back in 2020, just as COVID was hitting the world, Chris Patten, the former governor, British governor of Hong Kong, the last one, talked about post-peak China. And there was somewhat of a celebration, I would say, in the Western media at China's travails. The idea that China had kind of come a cropper, if you like, that COVID had originated there, that there were going to be lockdowns, that China's influence was waning as a result of the pandemic, okay? And you see that echoed in other places as well. I'm not sure that is the case. And I'll talk a little bit about that, but we can talk about it in the Q&A as well. But China does face a variety of problems economically. In particularly, the economically active population is due to shrink by 194 million people by 2050. So China's population declined for the first time ever last year, and the economically active population is set to decline dramatically in the coming years. Now, there are ways of plugging that through immigration and other things you can do. China also faces the so-called middle income trap. What's the middle income trap? The middle income trap is where you may be able to grow your economy quickly off a low base, But once you try and get to the technological frontier, you run up against patents, you run up against highly competitive incumbents, mostly Western-based, who kind of block your entry into that higher value-added sectors, robotics, artificial intelligence, and so on. Although China has a plan, a variety of plans, Made in China 2025, and the China 2035 standards plan to try and break out of this middle income trap. And some people claim that was also one of the motivations for the Belt and Road Initiative, that the Chinese economy was reaching its limits in terms of what could be achieved internally, and there was a need to kind of open the field of capital accumulation for Chinese companies globally, and the Belt and Road being part of that. Now, according to an economist, Sharma, last year, you know, at purchasing power parity, China is the world's biggest economy. So with Chinese money, what you can buy in China, it's the world's biggest economy. But it's still about a third smaller than the US in US dollar terms, okay? And this is a bone of geopolitical contention, let's say. And again, there was some celebration, there were some estimates done that you see here, the Chinese economy will not overtake the US until 2060, if ever. Previously, it was projected that was going to happen this decade, at the end, towards the end of this decade. So again, there's potential shift here, but we'll talk about that. At the same time, the Chinese president talks about things like winning the initiative and having the dominant position. So the old strategy of biding your time, not projecting yourself forcefully onto the international stage in order to not attract negative attention from the United States in particular, has now been displaced as China has grown its economy, its geopolitical weight, it's modernized its military. There's a different impetus, outlook, and perspective on China's role in the world, at least in the Chinese policy elite. Now again, this all interpenetrates with and is influenced by economics. So this is a graph showing percentage of GDP accounted for, manufacturing value added as a percentage of GDP. You can see China's share falling there. So there's a process of servitization of the Chinese economy. Okay, and again, some people kind of think this is a good thing. It's a form of rebalancing. But it can be exaggerated. The Chinese economy is still growing quite rapidly, and so manufacturing is still growing, even if not as fast as the service sector. Okay, so this is why you see this trend. But you see here, Apple has made little progress moving manufacturing out of China. So you see the different products there, AirPods, iPods, and so on. You see the vast majority is still made in China. So it's still the workshop of the world. Okay, we have to be cognizant of that. But its economic growth is in long-term or secular decline. It's very easy, or relatively easier, I should say, not very easy. It's relatively easier to grow your economy at 10% off a low base. When you get up into middle-income status, it becomes much, much more difficult, right? Because you've got a much bigger economy. And you see, these are the International Monetary Fund projections. China, at one point, was growing at 15% a year. Incredible rates of growth. Now it's around 5%. Okay, still a fast rate of economic growth for the kind of economy that China is. Let's talk a little bit about the Belt and Road Initiative. So the Chinese government has never produced a map of the Belt and Road Initiative. And some people have said this is strategic. Why would they not do that? And in a way, it serves a useful geopolitical function. Its fuzziness serves a useful geopolitical function. It can be shape-shifting. It can be whatever the Chinese government wants it to be at any particular time. If you formalize, categorize it too much, then people can say, oh, well, you're deviating from the plan. But if you leave it very vague, it provides a kind of discursive envelope where a variety of different things can be embedded in it. So these are some of the main routes for the Belt and Road Initiative. It's focused on Eurasia. Some people say that's in response to the American pivot to Asia, that it's forcing China to kind of look west, if you like. And if we're trying to think about what it is, this is from a paper with Jim Murphy last year, what is the content of the Belt and Road Initiative. Well, it interpenetrates with other vectors, and because it's fuzzy, you can include a lot of things potentially in it. But it has three things, we said: spatial forms, special economic zones, railroads, those kinds of concrete manifestations, which begin as ideation, of course, someone's idea to build a special economic zone or to have a Belt and Road Initiative at all, but it concretely manifests as spatial forms. It's associated with particular forms of constitutive flows. So money has to come from China, loans typically, to build the infrastructure. Steel and cement, workers, all sorts of other flows, okay? And counterflows. Once the infrastructure is built, some people have said that facilitates primarily raw material exports back out from China, or back out from Africa, and manufactured goods into Africa. And that's what the trade pattern broadly looks like. And it's facilitated by alliances, treaties, aid agreements, governance agreements, and so on. And you'll see here, each of these three categories have different things associated with them. In the interest of time, maybe I won't go too much in detail. I'll refer you to the paper. You're going to keep me to time, István. But there's couplings. For this structure to eventuate, there has to be strategic couplings of interests between African and Chinese political elites and economic elites. And that results in integrations, okay? Spatial integrations with particular economic, political, environmental, and social impacts. And I'll talk about a few of them. Okay, so what is changing Chinese engagements with Africa driven by? Well, the first thing is the last couple of years has become very evident there have been major problems with this Belt and Road Initiative. It was kind of foregrounded as something which was going to be transformational. It was going to lead to a new form of economic development, connectivity worldwide, where we would have a shared destiny for humanity, according to Chinese government pronouncements. Okay? But it's had large-scale problems, and also the Western powers have weaponized, and some other countries, the discourse of the BRI, in particular through the meme of debt-trap diplomacy, the idea that China is deliberately trying to entrap countries in debt in order to compromise their sovereignty and exercise a kind of neo-imperial control over them. Now, that's largely been debunked, but it doesn't mean that it isn't a problematic program, and I'll talk about that. We talked about the domestic economic slowdown, the changing global geopolitical context, the trade war with the US. And the response in China to that was a new policy called dual circulation, where the internal economy is emphasized supposedly as much as the export-oriented nature of the Chinese economy, which had largely driven growth previously. Africa's place in China's geopolitical code is also shifting, and China seems to want to avoid, again, it's hard to know what goes on in people's heads, but if you look at the statistics, you can discern trends. At one point in the 2010s, Africa accounted for about a third of Chinese total oil imports. Now it's down to 13%. So the Chinese government seems to, we can't know, want to avoid excessive reliance on any world region. Tries to diversify its partners and suppliers globally in order to avoid excessive dependence. In this changing global context, even as Africa may be becoming less economically important to China, nonetheless, its geopolitical importance seems to be rising, particularly in the context of the war in Ukraine and the crystallization of the different blocs around that, the Western-led, if you want to call it that, bloc, versus the alternative bloc, which some people say includes China and Russia. Okay, but the Belt and Road, as a form of spatial connectivity, generated its own contradictions, and I think this is the fundamental problem. So there's a whole geopolitics and weaponization, but as an economic and political project, it has its own contradictions. What are these? First one, poor investment appraisal. So China, after the global financial, or sorry, North Atlantic financial crisis, I should call it, massively stimulated the economy. And between 2011 and 2013, more cement was poured in China than in the United States during the entire 20th century. And that led to massive overcapacity issues in cement, in steel, and so on that had to be exported. And this was a fundamental driver of the Belt and Road Initiative. And so the projects that were built, the ports, the railways, and so on, often had poor investment appraisal. They weren't necessarily economic in their own terms. Okay? And there are some spectacular examples of that that I'll talk about a little bit later. In order to fund many of these projects, you have to go into oftentimes debt. Okay? And debt is a bet on the future. If you take money and you invest it and get a rate of return which is higher than the interest rate, then it's an economic kind of prospect, right? If the rate of return is lower than the interest rate, you're going to lose money on it. That's not to say you don't do it. Sometimes it can make sense for governments to invest in loss-making things as public goods if they unlock broader economic potential, but many of these projects haven't. I'll talk a little bit about this. Environmental and labour issues. Geopolitical blowback. We've talked about this meme of debt trap diplomacy, which originated in India. And also in a paper with Joel Wainwright last year, we argue that the fact that the BRI is both a geoeconomic and a geopolitical project exposes it to enhanced risk, okay? Because things can go wrong politically, things can go wrong economically, and they can interact together, okay? So, I don't know, apologies, I didn't know the size of the screen when I was doing up this graphic. But this is from that paper with Joel Wainwright, where we try and systematize the contradictions of the Belt and Road Initiative. Why are oftentimes African political elites interested in loans to fund infrastructure projects like the big standard multi-billion dollar standard gauge railway in Kenya? Well, they generate short-term economic growth, jobs, they boost the economy. The president of Kenya inaugurated the railway a couple of weeks before the 2017 election. Okay, so there's a political business cycle sometimes at work, right? But there can be potential repayment problems and so on. But it serves to maintain political regimes, but potentially reduce economic growth over the longer term if these are not economically viable prospects. Then it talks about the impacts on China, the boost to economic growth of exporting more cement, steel, and so on. There's exposure, there are risks to default. Will your partners default? And I'll talk a little bit about how this has been managed. But the overall function, we argue, in a paper with Ian actually, is that this serves as a form of a spatial fix, which is a way of displacing your domestic economic problems onto other countries. Maybe you can defer them in time through debt, but somebody will have to pay for them ultimately. And this spatial fix is reproduced. And I'll talk more about that during the course of the talk. Okay. We talked a little bit about this. If borrowers default, that could lead to blowback for China. Okay, it could affect its international reputation. So China wants to avoid that. Okay, because it'll make things difficult internationally. Now, according to Deng in a book last year, he says, there's a difference between China and the United States. China does not supply global public goods in the way that the US does or did. Stability, whether you agree with them or not, stability, free trade, some people would count, I wouldn't personally, as a global public good, some people say that. So it doesn't have and lead these international institutions the way that the United States did or does. Okay, let's talk a little bit about some specific projects. I've mentioned this standard gauge railway in Kenya. If you look at it, the China Road and Bridge Corporation took 800,000 cubic meters of sand from beaches and reefs around Mombasa, destroying the reefs without permits. So there can be massive environmental impacts. And again, that's a form of displacement. The economic growth which is generated in China through exports, for example, results in environmental degradation in other places. Ian, in a paper in the African Studies Quarterly in 2020, noted that the SGR costs 6% of Kenya's gross domestic product to build, and for every 7.8 tons of cargo transported from Mombasa inland, manufactured goods coming in, high-value manufactured goods, only 1.01 tons are railed back to the point of export, mostly low-value-added raw materials and natural resources. And this is just volume, it's not value. It's even worse if you look at value. Okay? So this has led some people to argue that this is an extractivist form of economic engagement. And the Chinese government also became worried about the contradictions of the Belt and Road Initiative. This is from a paper with Timza Jones and Ricardo Ribeiro from last year. And you'll see here new Chinese official loan commitments for new projects to Africa. What do you see? From 2016, it drops off a cliff. So again, the Chinese president talks about the need to avoid building vanity projects, for example. They become aware that things are going wrong, okay? And so new loan commitments dramatically decrease. And things have emerged in the last couple of weeks that in fact China has been giving emergency loans to many of the countries along the Belt and Road to prevent default through the mechanism of currency swaps. So what is this? This is where the People's Bank of China gives you Chinese yuan, you give them whatever your currency is nationally in exchange. So it's not quite a loan, but you're exchanging a hard currency for a soft currency. So in effect, it serves the same kind of function. So there have been huge bailouts, tens and tens of billions of these emergency loans given to Belt and Road countries. And you'll see in six African countries this has been the case: Angola, Sudan, South Sudan, Egypt, Tanzania, and Kenya. There's President Uhuru Kenyatta inaugurating the SGR. Of this emergency lending, 80% was post-2016. And the average credit rating for a country in the Belt and Road Initiative is not investment grade, or what market traders call junk. Okay, so the loans were being given to countries which did not have stable financial conditions, according to their problems with the rating agencies as well, and I don't want to belittle them. But now, according to Cobus von Standen, this was an acknowledgement that the BRI is as much about relationship building as it is about infrastructure, showing your all-weather friendship. Agnes will be talking about this later. When you're in difficulty, China will be there for you to bail you out, give you new loans, okay? But there's a different way of reading it, which is that it's also about not losing initial loan investments and also public relations. China has not participated fully in the multilateral debt relief initiatives that have been ongoing since COVID. It did participate in the debt suspension initiative for a couple of years, but there's now a bone of contention over China's non-participation. Why is this? Well, if you look at China internally, domestically, the China Development Bank does not write off loans internally. It's the agency charged with building infrastructure internally, you know, one of them in China. And it can't afford to write off loans because then the whole model comes unstuck. And the same principle is applied internationally. If you start to write down these big loans, that will go down badly amongst your lenders in China as well. Why are people overseas getting debt relief or elimination, whereas we're still having to pay for our loans? This is a graph showing the different types of emergency lending arrangements. Again, I'll circulate maybe the PowerPoint afterwards. But the People's Bank of China swap drawings are by far the biggest one. Here you see the geography of these bilateral bailouts, as the report calls them. Okay, so that's one set of issues. China has also had, in recent years, a variety of other problems in terms of its image on the continent, in particular things like labor abuses. This is a video on the left-hand side from Kenya, where a Chinese hotel manager, was seen caning a waiter for being late to work. This is just one instance. There have been a variety of scandals around Chinese actors and actresses, or actors, I guess, appearing in blackface at New Year's Eve celebrations in China. Not once, but repeatedly. So that you have a scandal, and then it happens again. So there are a variety of issues. Now, that's not to downplay racism and labor abuses by other companies or other nationalities at all, but nonetheless, these things are happening and contribute to the image problem, if you like. Now, according to Anita Plummer, in her book this year, she says, and she interviews many, many people in Kenya about Chinese engagements and the role of the public in ensuring accountability or trying to ensure accountability for Chinese projects. I believe people who say that this particular moment, China's interventions feel like neocolonialism. I would add that Kenyan elites, those who hold a disproportionate amount of wealth and power, have taken the position of supporting Chinese public and private actors operating in Kenya over the protests of citizens, especially on issues related to climate and environment, hiring practices, and the debt burden. And you see this kind of discourse also repeated in other media, such as this painting here by the Ghanaian artist Michael Soy. Okay, again, some people might find that sensationalist and so on, but these discourses are nonetheless out there. Okay, so have we reached... We saw the figures for Chinese loans. Let's look at some of the other vectors of engagement. China-Africa trade. You can see a dramatic decrease here after the global commodity price bust of 2014. Okay, but you can see, so that's not surprising to see the dramatic reduction in 2016. But you can see there, the trade balance favors China. Okay, so Africa runs a trade deficit with China. Okay, so again, this has led some people to say this is an extractivist type of economic relationship. What about foreign direct investment stocks and flows? Well, again, both of these have been in decline. So Chinese investors investing less on a yearly basis, but the stock, the existing already invested capital, also declining in some years. Okay. Talked a little bit about the diversification of oil supplies. Many of you are probably familiar with the Fora on China-Africa Cooperation, FOCAC, and that has also seen funding being scaled back. So funding commitments fell in sub-Saharan Africa 54% in 2022 to only $7.5 billion, a relatively small amount. This is going in tandem with pushback by Western powers on China. And again, I won't rehearse this too much, you're familiar with most of it. But according to some estimates, the United States is now Kenya's biggest trading partner again because of the African Growth and Opportunity Act. That's disputed. Some people place the US still fourth or fifth. I've seen different statistics on this. China has also, with its reshaping of its own geopolitical image and international code, geopolitical code, developed the idea of major country diplomacy, right? That China is a major country, the US is a major country, these are the big players, and they should set the kind of scene globally, geopolitically. So this is an explicit policy, major country diplomacy. Despite the emphasis on South-South cooperation and the supposed equality, sovereign equality between nations, in practice, China has kind of breached that principle through this policy of major country diplomacy. We need to focus on the big players. Okay? And one of the impacts of that, declining economic commitments on trade and so on, has been that aid has become an important vector, or more important vector, of Chinese engagement with Africa. China never used to talk about aid. It was always South-South globalization, win-win cooperation. So now they talk about aid. And this, in a sense, mirrors the Western partners, if you want to call them that, patterns of engagement with the continent, okay? Problematically. Okay, so, but Africa is still important to China, geopolitically, as I've talked about. There's more emphasis on aid and market opening to offset other economic exchanges that Lina Ben Abdella has talked about, who is listening into us today. And market opening has, in some cases in China, been quite dramatic. So recently, Beijing announced that it was dropping imports on $300 billion worth of goods and 98% of tariffs on imports from Burundi, Ethiopia, and Nigeria, for example. This is significant. It doesn't sit quite so easily with the neocolonialism discourse. This is something different. When the British colonized India, they restricted textile imports from India because they were better, they were cheaper. So the British actually banned imports of calico from India. This is a different type of engagement, and it speaks to the fact that we have juridical sovereignty and that African political elites serve as market and resource gatekeepers. So they can't be treated the same way as the colonists treated their colonial subjects. Okay? There has to be a negotiation, a bargaining process, and a coupling of strategic interests for these relations to be maintained and arguably deepened. From that paper with Tim and Ricardo, Tim came up with this term, competitive developmentalism, that the idea that China and the US and the Europeans are all competing. The Western powers now have the Global Gateway Initiative and the Blue Dot Initiative, which are also infrastructure programs. But they can't marshal the same resources that the Chinese state can, because the Chinese state holds the world's largest foreign exchange reserves, $3.2 trillion, I was going to say billion, and it's stated hundreds of thousands of state-owned enterprises in that country. Okay? But the Western powers have woken up, if you like, to the competition, some people might say, and the DRC signed an agreement to develop the electric vehicle value chain with the US in 2020. Okay? 70% of the world's cobalt is found in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and this is a key component for electric vehicles, right? So the strategic importance of certain minerals is continuing to grow in this green transition. Okay, so how do we think about this in terms of the nature of Chinese global power? There's a debate in the literature. Is there an all-powerful central state directing Chinese actors around the world? Or is it a diffuse, decentralized competition between companies which is largely driving the nature of engagements, right? And in the literature, there's a consensus that it's not one or the other. So Breslin talks about bounded autonomy, that state-owned enterprises can compete with each other within certain limits, and if they do something the central government doesn't like, then they get reined back in, okay? Jones and Hameri talk about the regulatory Chinese state. But many states are regulatory. The French state is regulatory, or the Hungarian state, I'm sure, as well. Okay? So there are a couple of key features about the nature of Chinese geoeconomic and political engagements. Firstly, China engages with a broader range of actors than other states, according to Walsh. This is from another recent book by Jody Yu Zhao Sun. In a nutshell, one could say there is a significant degree of hybridity between capitalism goes global and socialism goes global. So merging planning with the market, right? This new form of state capitalism of which China is the primary exemplar. Okay. And the overall objectives of what Rush Doshi calls partial hegemony, or what in a paper with Ian we called flexible hegemony or flexigemony, still exist. Okay? And so in a project I'm developing with some colleagues at Trinity and Jim Murphy also in the US, we're developing this idea of web power. That is that the Chinese state operates differently and has a different form of power projection, or a stronger form of web power projection. What is web power? Web power is where the central state is able to, if not coordinate, then heavily regulate and influence the behavior of nominally independent actors like the private sector or civil society. Some of you may remember Jack Ma's disappearance, you know, the founder of Alibaba, but one of the world's richest people, disappeared a couple of years ago for several months, only to appear at an event celebrating rural teachers after not being seen for months. You can think about the corporate social credit system in China, which is a way of making sure corporate actors don't get out of line. So it's the contradiction and the integration of a powerful centre which is able to project its power and regulate other social actors and influence them through a variety of different mechanisms. And there are a whole host of those, subsidies, and I don't have time to go into. If you look at this schematic, and again, apologies for the size, this web power is manifest through a variety of different axes. This is focused on the economic dimensions. China primarily exercises power economically. It's never invaded another country, unlike some other countries, but it does exercise its power economically. Maybe not letting Filipino bananas in because they, in theory, don't meet phytosanitary standards, and leaving them on the dock for a week or two, which doesn't do much for their sale price, for example. Okay. But you can think about other things like standards, the profusion of Chinese standards around railways, around artificial intelligence, around all sorts of advanced technologies. And once you lock people into your standards, that guarantees your market into the future. Okay? And that's one of the things the Western countries have been very successful in corporations at doing historically. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about this idea of post-peak China. And we'll talk for a minute or two about the Zambian case. Zambia had the first overseas bank and mine from China in the late 1990s. It's a major copper producer, and in fact, it was the world's largest exporter of raw copper, I think last year. Okay? The world's biggest exporter of copper. And China consumes a massive proportion of the world's copper. President Sata, when he was elected in 2011, had run on a kind of anti-Chinese campaign. He said things like, we need investors, not infestors, in his prior election campaign. Who was his first visitor to State House upon his election as president? The Chinese ambassador. So he was enrolled in the copper export-oriented assemblage by virtue of the structure of the Chinese economy. He realized immediately, of course, this wasn't a sustainable position to antagonize your primary trade partner. Okay. The Patriotic Front, as commodity prices fell and President Sata died in office, the Patriotic Front went on what Tim Zajonc has called a road bonanza to try and keep the economy growing, borrowing money, building roads, and so on. And Zambia became the first African country to default on its debts during COVID. Okay? So we could think about it as a site where these contradictions are perhaps very clearly or most clearly expressed. Have a look at Zambian government debt to GDP, right? You can't actually see the figures there, but it ramps up dramatically, okay, over the space of around a decade or so. If you look at the US response, you've probably noticed in the media, Janet Yellen visiting a variety of African countries, Kamala Harris there a couple of weeks ago during a tour of the continent, Jill Biden and Joe Biden is slated to visit the continent as well. In the Zambian case, the US Secretary Treasury, Janet Yellen, called Beijing a barrier to the resolution of Zambia's debt. And the Chinese reaction said the US government should act on responsible monetary policies, cope with its own debt problem, and stop sabotaging other sovereign countries' active efforts. But the US and Chinese ambassadors did meet subsequently to this to try and dial down the temperature a little bit. If you look at Zambian exports to China, again, you can see a dramatic decline, kind of mirroring the copper price, and then as the copper price has gone back up, increased exports. Exports to China, and then Chinese exports to Zambia. Again, you can see they're off their peak. China is very sensitive to the criticism that it exports food from Africa, and Deborah Breitigan has a book about this called Will Africa Feed China? And they have a domestic food security target of 80 to 90%. Okay, so they don't export that much food from their state-owned farms, for example, in Zambia and elsewhere. Nonetheless, these are, you see there, $134 million of food exports in 2014 from Zambia, but again, in decline. Now, we can also think about counter cases, and in particular, Djibouti, where you have this Durella multi-facility port special economic zone, and a recently announced spaceport, Chinese spaceport. So according to Benjamin Barton in his recent book, the whirlwind triggered by the early BRI funding pledges spurred China merchants to behave more audaciously in Djibouti. And it was also the site of China's first overseas military base in a long time in 2017. If you look at the countries globally that are most indebted to China, three of the top five are in Africa. In Djibouti, 43% and up to 70% by some other estimates of GDP equivalent in debt to China. Okay. So, does this mean we're in an era of post-peak China? Well, it depends on the regime type, how it articulates and negotiates and uses the nature of dependent relations. Where it's successful, there may be more appetite for deeper engagement. Anita Plummer highlights the role of publics, their key role in African politics. So, are we post-peak or post-apeak? Prediction in social science is famously wrong, risky consequently, so I'm not going to do it. But the Chinese economy is projected to grow at 5.2% in 2023 this year. It has rapidly rebounded. If that rate of growth was maintained, that would give a doubling time of 14 years, by which time it would overtake well the United States as the world's biggest economy. The US has restricted high-tech electronic chip exports, right? This may reduce or constrain the nature of economic growth in China. And there's an estimate of 1 yuan worth of chips can support 10 yuan worth of electrical capacity and generates 100 yuan of economic output. Okay, there's some return to financing of infrastructure in Africa. So a recent loan to Nigeria for the Kaduna-Kano Railway has been negotiated, but at a commercial rate. So not at a soft lending rate. And China accounts for 85% of Nigeria's bilateral debt. So the biggest economy in Africa, 85% of bilateral state-to-state debt is with China. But there's greater borrowing and lending caution. Okay, so what will the future depend on? Well, it'll obviously depend on the evolution of the Chinese political economy. We can't predict that. It'll depend on changes in African political economy. Global geopolitics, including climate geopolitics. And if we're applying an economistic terminology to the nature of these relations, we could say the economic and political demand for Africa will depend on the conjunction and interpenetration of these three factors, I argue. Okay? And the supply of markets, raw materials, and geopolitical support will depend on the perceived benefits for different actors at different timescales. Thank you.
Fantastic overview, I guess, a very critical overview of the topic. We have now quite a bit of time, actually, to raise further questions, ask questions, or give some comments. And I'm going also to watch in the meantime if we receive online any questions or comments so that we can take those as well. But please take the floor and ask any comments or questions or make any comments or questions. And Attila, the microphone, this one, will be traveling around. Oh, no, there's another one over there. So raise your hand and you are given the mic. Yes, Dr. Tubani over there first, and Oscar after.
Good morning, and thank you very much for a very illuminating paper presentation here. One of the questions that intrigues me is that during the negotiations for the Chinese investments in various African massive projects, we often hear about African governments putting up some valuable assets as collaterals. in the event of any default of the loans. Are there any examples whereby such defaults have happened and African governments have been really put to test to turn over those assets to the Chinese control?
Yeah. So again, this speaks to the idea of debt trap diplomacy. You know, are governments, not just in Africa, but around the world, mortgaging critical national assets like airports, ports, and so on, as collateral for these debts? So there's a couple of things to say. The first one is the sovereign exception clause is a regular feature in commercial lending contracts. So it's not something that is just used by China. So it's something which, if you borrow from Western vendors, they will have a sovereign exception. So it's basically, you can't claim that you can change your own laws and wipe out the debt, right? It has to be subject to international arbitration. Typically in London, in commercial contracts, but the Chinese have now set up their own international arbitration court in Hong Kong, I think, right? There haven't been, there's been huge controversies in Africa about the Mombasa port and the standard gauge railway, for example, but it's quite standard practice in a lot of ways. What is different about the contracts is that often they're very opaque. They're not made public what the terms are. Okay? The Chinese banks often require African governments to co-fund these projects as well, so the Chinese entities don't assume all of the risk, so they're often co-funded projects. That, again, probably makes sense. So the short answer to your question is not really in Africa. Chinese companies did take over the Laotian power grid in Asia, for example. There's the famous case of the Hambantota port in Sri Lanka, which Deborah Brautigan has written. It's not a simple kind of resource grab where the port was taken over. It was the Sri Lankan government couldn't service its debt. There was a new loan given in exchange for a 99-year lease. In Zambia, the television station, I guess, or one of the TV stations was, you'll know more about this, Agnes, to a Chinese company as well. There was some controversy about that, but not really is the answer to your question. So this debt trap diplomacy narrative hasn't really been proven by the facts.
Oscar, yeah.
Thank you.
It's on.
On?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Prof, for your presentation, and to all participants, thank you for coming. An interesting perspective on BRI's contradiction, and particularly for the case of SGR in Kenya. Maybe just to add an observation in addition to your outline in terms of the contradictions of BRI. What I see as a major concern is the main objective, the way BRI is conceptualized, visualizing to connect various entities, particularly around continents. In different continents, but in Africa, and that brings us to the discussion on regional integration. Now, ironically, as more and more governments are seeking to sign these agreements to start implementing infrastructure projects, this has created some infrastructural race. I've talked about that elsewhere. And we are seeing that race in a way militating against the idea of regional integration. So, for example, in East Africa community, you find Kenya and Tanzania are at loggerhead in terms of the nature and the extent of implementation. And therefore, BRI may just contribute to that problem of regional integration. To my second concern quickly is I would have also wished that you put more emphasis on the discussion on debt trap diplomacy, and particularly the increasing appetite of African government to opt for Western commercial loans, and the challenge they are recently facing to repay. We looked at those statistics recently with our colleague in South Africa, and we realized that the number of our Western commercial loans are on increase compared to Chinese loan. Thanks.
I think they were comments.
Okay.
Barney Walsh's book talks about the East African community and the challenges China presents for... So the East African community, according to him, has a competence in infrastructure development. That's meant to be something which is... The plans are meant to be developed regionally and rolled out regionally. But the fact that these loans are negotiated bilaterally with Chinese companies, or in the Tanzanian case, a Turkish company building the standard gauge railway there, complicates those efforts. So his book has got good on that.
Thank you for your presentation. I'd like to ask or to comment for your comment on the aspect of, leave alone the SGRs, the mega projects, and all those other things. In Africa and in Kenya, there's a lot of interaction at personal level, at small scale level, with African small scale business persons traveling to to China, bringing back goods, and now with the small scale Chinese businesses coming into Kenya and into Africa, and starting to face some resistance from the local small scale businesses, and what that has to say to this whole idea of China taking over Africa, and where the resistance will come from in the end. So that's one. The other one is, as I look around and I look at the first, I'm not sure that it was the first, but colonization of Africa by the Europeans, and now the threat or the perceived threat of the same. And I'm wondering, and you will probably not have the answer, which one is worse for the Africans? I've been thinking that with the old one, at least we know who was where. Now, with the Chinese, we are not quite sure. But just your comment on these things,
okay.
Please.
Thank you. So again, I'd recommend Anita Plummer's book. She's really good, talking about the role of publics in Kenya in restraining. So there's a group called the Decolonized Coalition in Kenya, which has been campaigning against coal-fired power plants, for example, and a variety of other ways in which publics have been able to restrain maybe some of the worst excesses. There was the controversy around tilapia imports in Kenya, wasn't there? Where the government did eventually, I think, ban Chinese tilapia imports for a time because fishers were saying they couldn't meet the cost competition. So the African states, like any states, have to balance and negotiate different social forces and actors. And different social forces can exert more or less power at different points in time. So it's not that people are powerless or publics are powerless, far from it. And the state has to pay attention oftentimes, even authoritarian states, like China itself, has to pay significant attention to what the public wants. Where will the resistance come from? I think you talked about that. People in markets, obviously the mining communities in Zambia, there was a mining explosion in 2005 before the election where 50 miners... they weren't miners, they were actually working in an explosives factory without any training, were killed. And that set off, along with other things, a wave of kind of anti-Chinese rioting in Zambia. So there's resistance in different places and times. And again, Oscar was talking about now the shift back towards the Western partners in terms of lending and geopolitical influence and orientation, right? So resistance will also come from certain political elites, again, depending on how, what their own personal kind of beliefs are, but also how they feel public opinion is moving and their key constituencies. So resistance can come in different ways, in different times, at different places. One of the differences between colonialism and Chinese engagement is that Chinese engagement and power is fundamentally projected through something I call commodity power. What's commodity power? Commodity power is where you have such competitive manufacturing, mostly products, that local producers can't compete with them. And that strengthens not only Chinese-centered capital, but it also strengthens this Chinese state by virtue of the tax revenue which is generated and mobilized by those products being produced in China. So it's a fundamentally geoeconomic form of power which has similarities and differences to colonialism. I mean, the outrages of colonialism, I think China can only, even labor abuses and so on, can only pale in comparison to the horrific human rights abuses that were committed during the colonial era. So I don't know if that kind of speaks to your question.
Well, first of all, I would like to thank you for the precise presentation, and it was really beneficial. But I would love to ask you and add a little comment. There was a comparison between the European post-colonial powers and the Chinese influence, or the rise or the increasing Chinese influence in the continent of Africa. But I would also like to ask you, first of all, what is the difference between the Chinese influence and the post-colonial powers' influence? That's the first thing. And the second question would be also around when or how these African countries can be liberated from what's so-called the diplomacy of the debt trap. Is there a way of escaping it? That's the... Also, I would love to mention regarding to the labor abuse and racism and the violation of human rights that the Chinese... are not any, I would say, less brutal than what the Europeans did in the African continent. Nobody has his hands clear of blood.
Okay.
And, so I would love to elaborate my question about how can African, is there a financial policy that can escape the diplomacy of that trap? Thank you very much, Professor.
Sure. So I think the first thing to say is people are people. We're all complex. We're driven by different emotions. There are cultural differences, but fundamentally, I think people are people, and some people can be brutal and cruel and harsh, irrespective of their nationality. And many people, of course, are lovely and sociable and cooperative and so on and so forth. And that's the primary mode of human engagement. We tend to pay attention to the other side of human nature, which comes to the fore at times. It's an interesting question about how to negotiate China, right? So China is the largest market for African exports. In some years, it's the biggest investor, although it's been falling. And by stock, it's still, I think, only around fourth position. The Netherlands is even higher than China in terms of the stock of foreign investment. Different countries have been able to negotiate China differently. So the regime type is incredibly important. Meles Zenawi, when he was Prime Minister of Ethiopia, went to China and convinced Chinese investors to come and set up special economic zones in India, in Ethiopia, for example, and was able to leverage engagements with China. Now, the main export from Ethiopia to China was still sesame seeds and nuts, I think, so the nature of the dependent relationship wasn't reconfigured by those engagements, but nonetheless it allowed for some manufacturing diversification. It also came with debt, some of which has been fairly recently rescheduled, and obviously we've had the civil war and the whole thing has come unstuck, but for other political, internal political reasons as well. In terms of the difference between China and the so-called post-colonial powers, I think the big difference is in the nature of the Chinese state-society complex, as manifest through this web power that I was talking about. So whereas in Western countries you have a relatively autonomous private sector, civil society, and governmental sector, that's not the case in China. And what that means is that China is able to much more effectively leverage different axes of power, and it has a multi-vector engagement across the continent. So in the same way as there was no country not of interest to the United States after World War II, there's now no country on the planet not of interest to the Chinese government. Obviously, some still recognize Taiwan, so there isn't as much engagement. And the hundreds of thousands of state-owned corporations which can be leveraged to not follow the Chinese government's bidding. Many of those are provincial corporations and city corporations, but nonetheless, they're subject to extensive influence, and their chief executives are promoted and embedded in the Chinese Communist Party hierarchy, which operates an incredibly tight... So the Chinese state, I'd argue, is largely a creature and reflection of the Chinese Communist Party, which doesn't have a legal existence in China. It doesn't legally exist. It can never be sued. It's coordinated through something called the Red Phone Network. There are about 3,000 people with red phones on their desks, and there's a special military unit that directs their calls through this Red Phone Network. They're meant to be able to recognize people by voice alone. So there is extremely tight coordination internally in the Communist Party, and the organs of state are in some sense secondary to that highly coordinated, organized, disciplined, regulated social force that is the CCP.
First Emmanuel, where is the mic?
All right, thank you. My name is Emmanuel. Interestingly, I'm coming from China, but I'm originally from Ghana. Mine is a comment and the other is a question. My comment would be that talking about debt trap, I think one thing that maybe we can't, first of all, we can't talk about China, Africa without talking about the US. And so we see that there is gradually a shift towards China, Africa moving towards China in terms of loans and other things. And now US seems to reassure Africa that we are back on another thing. But I think we can't also lose sight of the fact that China engages in what we see as a non-interfering, even though it's questionable in terms of its debt and other things, comparing it to the Western side. So it's like you go to China for maybe a loan at, let's say, 20% interest rate, and maybe you go to US, let's say 10%. And here is the case, you go to US for that loan and US tells you, so let's, for example, why do you allow your children to watch TV after 10? If you continue to allow your children to watch TV after 10, I'm not going to give you, let's assume you have two bakery shops. One sells, they all sell the same bread, same ingredients. You go to one bakery shop and the baker tells you, my bread is 5, Hungarian money. You go to another one, he says, my bread is 20. You go to the 5 baker, and he tells you, why don't you allow your children to watch TV after 10? You are supposed to allow them to watch TV after 10. If you don't allow them, I'm not going to sell my bread to you. So now, and you, based on your what you've come to, you cannot allow your children to watch TV after 10. Looking at your circumstances and your resources. So now the alternative becomes the baker who sells the bread at 20, even though it's very expensive, but it has less issues to deal with. So I think we shouldn't also lose sight of that kind of relations China has with Africa. And I think the now that US is trying to get closer to Africa in terms of fighting Chinese influence and coming up Russia influence, they should also take a look at that. My question is, I have a statement I want to read just shortly. It says, America wants to keep reassuring the countries and leaders of Africa, like, we didn't forget you, you know. We were isolationists pretty much for the last 4 years of the administration. We want to say, hey, we are back. And this was First Lady Dr. Jill Biden talking after her visit to Africa. I want to ask, do you think that US renewed interest in Africa Is it a case of too late, too little? Yeah, that was the question.
So just to speak to your first point about conditionality, so Western loans typically, as you say, come with conditionality, the World Bank and the IMF, which we see many African countries now being subject to again, given the debt crisis on the continent. But if you think about it, there's been a rescaling of conditionality. So when you take sometimes loans from China, you have to do debt for infrastructure swaps and pay in resources. Maybe you have to use Chinese construction companies to build the project. So it's not that there's not conditionality, it's rescaled. Secondly, the non-interference principle has been weakening, and there are new strategic concepts in China like creative engagement. If you look at China's first overseas military bases, apparently there's plans to build others on the continent and elsewhere. You can think about the combat mission of Chinese troops in South Sudan in 2013, the first combat mission. Also, people say, if you're supplying Robert Mugabe's regime with weapons, radio jamming equipment, and other things to beat and suppress the opposition, is that non-interference? Is that what we're defining as non-interference? So again, non-interference is a discursive construction which is very malleable and subject to interpretation and change depending on the political, geopolitical context and you know, consequences around it. Yes. In terms of it, too little, too late from the US, well, I mean, this is great power competition. So, you know, it's not a question of being in favor of the US or against China. This is great power competition to access resources, markets, geopolitical support, and other things of interest, in addition to being driven by other motives like humanitarianism and altruism. Again, people are complex. We're not just driven by materiality. We have emotions, we have values, we have ideas ourselves, right? So you can't oversimplify it. So I think the Chinese government has such power advantages that the US government and European governments will find it very, very difficult to compete, given the established position and the continuing power resources of the Chinese state.
Thank you, Professor, for the insightful presentation. My name is Tolera. I came from Ethiopia. Currently, I'm an exchange student at the University of Pécs. My question is related to Ethiopia and China's presence in Ethiopia, now moving from mega construction projects to owning shop in Addis Ababa. Small shops they are operating. To that extent, it's affecting the relation and the economic aspect, what you have already told us. But my question is related to the broader scope of Horn of Africa, where we see increasingly observing strategic convergence in the competition between superpowers and even the middle powers, where China also has shown interest in the, despite the using software and soft power, now they are moving to a kind of using another style, as you have already pointed out. And for example, currently there is a crisis in Sudan, there is war in Sudan, and from international media reports, we've seen that Sudan, China is still showing interest in the engagement of Sudan, the way, and my question is, now the tendency in the Horn of Africa is that there might be even to the level of confrontation. Because of those all factors, strategic resources, access to trade routes, market, the sea, and the that. Do you think, in one way or the other, Horn of Africa could be one of the areas where these superpowers might confront, one of the way, either military or in proxy war, as they have been practicing?
Sure, thank you. So I think that has already happened previously to an extent, where in the conflict between Sudan and South Sudan, if you want to call them that, you know, the Chinese sided effectively with the They maintained relations with the Southerners also, because there's no harm in maintaining relations, good relations with everybody. But and the Americans were pro, effectively, Southern Sudanese independence. So the Horn of Africa is a geopolitical fracture zone where you see periodically proxy wars being fought. I mean, I remember speaking to a British military officer and him saying to me, he was on a training mission. He said, well, you know, we train them, they're here fighting our wars for us, so we don't have to. So he was very explicit about it. He was talking about the Somali conflict at that time. So these things, these are not new things. I guess what is different in the current context is that we're in an era of what some people refer to now as the post-American world, where American hegemony is in decline and being vigorously contested. And the kind of global public good of stability and order, even though the United States breached that itself through illegal invasions in Iraq, for example, nonetheless had a suppressive effect on conflict, despite the massive social inequalities and political inequalities within and between states. Nonetheless, American hegemony had a broadly suppressive effect on conflict. But now we're in a new geopolitical era. There's been a revival, so-called revival of geopolitics, most acutely expressed through the invasion of Ukraine. And that, some people argue, is also part of what's happening in Africa, that as the United States is distracted and weakened and declining in relative power, although this is, again, dialectical, it's been able to leverage and build a coalition quite effectively to counter Russia and its invasion of Ukraine. So these things are dialectical, but I think that's what some people have argued that I've seen recently.
Yeah, Agnes, yeah.
I just wanted to add a quick word and underscore what you talked about in terms of Africans not being powerless. Because this is really the vision that we get most of the time is that China is in control and China is doing this and that Africans are powerless. The reverse is also true, that Africans do have agency and they do have power. And you see, for instance, in terms of how they negotiate, in terms of Ethiopia, for instance, Ethiopia was able to negotiate a better deal than, for instance, Kenya in terms of its building its rail line. In terms, you briefly alluded to, you know, South African workers refusing to download arms which were actually headed for Zimbabwe because they felt this was not right. You know, in terms of Zambia, you know, we have people, actually mine workers, really staging a protest against the president of China when he was coming to Zambia to visit different areas where you mentioned, you know, miners had been. And so when we talk about where is the resistance going to come from, it's going to come from pockets of people in African societies who see and feel the thing. So I just wanted to add that, you know, in our discussion and to think about that, that African societies are not completely, you know, powerless. You know, you see even in the negotiation in Angola, how they were able to negotiate for better deals. And so most of the time, what we get is that China is in control. But the reverse is also true. You know, in some cases, Africans have actually gone to court in Kenya, for instance, in terms of, you know, the environmental degradation, you know, to be able to change that course. So Africans have agency and they've exercised it at different levels, from the governmental level up to actually the grassroots level. I just wanted to add that.
Yeah, thank you so much for that. Before you comment on it, right away I'm jumping on it, and I would like to add to this geopolitical, you know, competitive kind of context. And yes, I would fully agree with this rising or growing African agency. So Africans deciding, choosing And there are so many options out there, yes? A lot of actors. You were talking about that, yes? And you also mentioned the competitive developmental geopolitics on the rise. So my question is, who do you think and see the major competitors for China in Africa?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so maybe just to follow up on Agnes's point first, Anna. So Benjamin Barton has a great book out about the Darella disputes, and he talks about the way the Goulet regime in Djibouti was able to leverage China for its own strategic objectives. Djibouti only became independent in 1977, but he was able to leverage Chinese investment to his own ends of regime maintenance and displacing other powers that were felt to be less beneficial, if you like, to that. So I think it's absolutely right. It's not that also there's differentiated levels of power that different people have. So some people may be very powerful, other people may have relatively limited power. So there's huge, huge differences. In terms of the major competitors, I mean, that's an interesting question. You could read it at two kinds of levels. You could read it at the level of great power geopolitical and geoeconomic competition, or you could read it at the level of competition around alternative visions of the future. You could read it from a kind of societal level. So what social forces internally in the continent will carry a progressive social agenda around which people can mobilize and through which external, in inverted commas, actors can be more effectively leveraged, negotiated, bargained with, and ultimately, hopefully, disciplined to achieve socioeconomic benefits for the majority of the population. In terms of the great power competition, I think, you know, Africa, it holds an interesting kind of discursive position. If you look at the total level of Chinese investment in the continent, it's around the same as there is in Germany. So one country in Europe, okay, the biggest economy in Europe, but nonetheless one country in Europe. But it serves as a space primarily of, I think, discursive contestation. And it serves a very useful discursive function. The foreign minister, Chinese foreign minister's first visit every year is to Africa. And that's putting a marker down. It's sending a signal that China is a southern country, that it has suffered under Western intervention and colonialism, not to the same degree maybe as many other places, but nonetheless there's that shared history there. And it serves as useful discursive function as a marker to the rest of the global south, other regions of which, particularly in Southeast Asia, are more economically important to China, that there is this enduring south-south solidarity. And in a sense, the renewed Western interest is, again, largely around discourse and the performative geopolitics, if I can call it that. That is that because Africans are perceived oftentimes and presented in Western media as being powerless and therefore easy prey to supposedly nefarious Chinese actors, that the West has a kind of moral duty to intervene and to offer an alternative to these supposedly, you know, predatory practices that are being put in place by Chinese actors.
A last question, Alan, over there, yes.
I would like to go back to the 1980s. In 1979, Moscow invaded and occupied Afghanistan. Jimmy Carter asked his U.S. client states not to go to the Moscow Olympics. Kenya did not send it, runner. And you know what? Winning medals means to the South African runner, literally, life, rugs. And obviously, Kenya did not make that decision out of its national interests. 4 years later, the Olympics were held in LA. Moscow reciprocated, asked its client states not to go. Ethiopia did not send its runners to Moscow. the victims were the runners. Doesn't that show that Africa is still colonized?
Okay.
Question. I don't think so. So it may have been a particular reading of interests, you know, that Kenya has traditionally been more aligned to the Western powers. I know the British and American militaries keep supplies, I think, in Kenya. There's training missions and so on. And Kenya has been more in the Western orbit, where obviously Ethiopia at that time was more in the Soviet orbit. And so I would say those decisions probably resulted from a reading of the material interests, not of the runners, but of the regimes in place and their political interests. So I don't think you can say that no, Africa is still colonized. As Agnes was getting at, African governments have a huge amount of latitude, even within the constraints of the neoliberal trade and international capital regimes, to be able to implement effective economic and social policies. But it's around the social constitution of African states, their constituencies, and ideation, the articulation of alternative visions. And there are some around that. There's an alternative economist network around finance being set up in Africa, I was hearing about the other week. Whereas the World Bank and the Western-led institutions have been very effective at socializing neoliberal economics into the African policy elites, it doesn't equate to colonization. You could say it's maybe hegemony, but to me, colonialism was direct territorial control associated with military invasion. And in a sense, military invasion was the precursor to economic globalization. So we're in a different era. There are huge power differences between different states and different social forces. So I'm not disputing that in any way, the massive power differentials that exist. But juridical sovereignty does offer African states, at least in theory, if oftentimes not in practice, the ability to institute and practice different sorts of economic and social policies which are potentially more inclusive and economically transformative. So, it's a complex question. There are elements of neocolonialism, for example. If you look at the trade structure, you know, the raw material exports for manufactured imports, we've seen that before. If you go to the National Famine Memorial in Ireland, you go up to the children's bedroom, it was an old Anglo-Irish stately home. There's a game called the Colonial Game, where they taught their children to export manufactured goods dear and import raw materials cheap. So those practices still continue. So I'm not in any way kind of disputing that, but it's complex.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the great questions and comments. And thank you, Professor Carmody, for this very illuminating overview. Thank you so much. Thank you.